Now celebrating our 22nd year of service to the amateur radio community around the world, we are This Week in Amateur Radio, North America's premier amateur radio and technology news magazine and bulletin service of the air. Here are the stories for release around the earth on this Field Day weekend 2021 as we come to air with edition number 1165 of This Week in Amateur Radio. The FCC releases a further notice in the satellite launch proceeding involving the use of 70 and 5 centimeter bands by independent space contractors. We will bring to you the results of the May volunteer monitoring program. The ARRL has formed a new partnership with emergency flashlight manufacturer Maglite. We will have all the details. There is a new petition in front of the FCC to add a fifth commissioner. The Netherlands announces new privileges and changes to its novice class license. The old Russian woodpecker over-the-horizon radar, known as Duga 1, is declared an historic cultural site by the Ukraine. The president of the International Amateur Radio Union discusses the future of amateur radio. The IARU also attended the workshop on the interference potential of wireless power transfer systems. We will have all the details. And amateurs and scientists aren't the only ones that track the sun, solar data, and space weather. The United States Post Office does too, and we will bring you this story and a lot more as we come to air with our special Field Day Edition 2021 of This Week in Amateur Radio. These headline stories will come to you in a moment along with this week's special features. We'll visit with Bruce Page, KK5DO, and get an update from AMSAT and what's new with all of those amateur satellites up there in orbit. Our technology reporter, Leo Laporte, W6TWT, will talk about states that are launching proof of vaccination apps and how people are gaming that system, and he will talk about the new version of Windows, Windows 11, that was announced by Microsoft this past Thursday. Australia's own Arno Benshoff, VK6FLAB, says that there be dragons here when you venture into uncharted territory. Our own amateur radio historian, Bill Continelli, W2XOY, returns with another edition of the Ancient Amateur Archives. This week, Bill takes a look at WARC 79, the late 70s 11-meter outbanders. The FCC OKs packet radio, and he will peek into the world of amateur radio in the year 1980. And our tower climbing and antenna master, Greg Stoddard, KF9MP, will present part 4 of his 6-part series on writing a successful public service announcement to promote your club's hamfest or meeting ahead of time on local broadcast radio. That's all straight ahead as North America's premier amateur radio and technology news magazine and bulletin service, This Week in Amateur Radio, takes to the air right now. Hoping you and your club are having a great Field Day weekend and reporting from our headquarters studio here in a very nondescript building in Albany, New York, I'm George, W2XBS.
And reporting from the newsroom in Half Moon, New York, I'm Terry Saunders, N1KIN.
Reporting from the Half Moon Lighthouse Park in Waterford, New York, this is N2WWW Field Day 2021.
And reporting from our amateur radio outpost in the Catskill Mountains of upstate New York, where we're looking forward to Field Day running a long wire antenna this year, I'm Don Hulick, K2ATJ.
And from Studio One of our Central Florida News Bureau, where it rains every afternoon, but then again it is Florida, I'm Fred, November Fox 2 Fox.
And reporting from yet another beautiful day, here in our Troy, New York News Bureau, I'm Eric Zittel, KD2, RJX.
And reporting from our news bureau in Fayetteville, Arkansas, where Mother Nature, with her now paid in full water bill, is promising more rain, and our crazy neighbor with the long flowing white beard is back building his huge boat and walking around muttering to himself about gathering animals two by two, I'm Will Rogers, K5WLR. Now where the heck did I put that little rowboat?
And now, with our lead story, here is Terry Saunders, N1KIN.
This is our lead story on this special Field Day weekend edition. The Federal Communications Commission is soliciting a second round of comments on whether to authorize commercial space entities to obtain licenses for frequencies used exclusively during space launch activities. For further details, we go to Rick Lindquist, WW1ME, reporting from League headquarters in Newington.
The proposals include parts of the 70 and 5 centimeter bands, although they appear to pose no danger to either secondary amateur allocation. The federal government has allocated this spectrum on a primary basis and routinely uses it during space launches, but commercial space companies must obtain short-term special temporary authority, or STA, authorizations from the FCC to use it for the same purpose. The last decade has seen a dramatic increase in commercial space launches. In April, the FCC adopted some of its proposals from 2013 and solicited additional comment in a further notice in the proceeding allocation of spectrum for non-federal space launch operations. The proposals would allow private commercial space companies to obtain regular FCC licenses instead of launch-specific STAs in a number of bands, including 420 to 430 megahertz and 5650 to 5925 megahertz. Comments are due on or before July 12th. Reply comments, those are comments on the comments already filed, are due on or before August 9th, 2021. I'm Rick Lindquist, WW1ME.
The federal government, including the U.S. Department of Defense, is the primary user of both bands. Amateur operations are allocated on a secondary basis. The FCC again seeks comment on whether it should give commercial space launch entities access to the same limited space launch uses already employed by the federal government on this spectrum. Primary federal users heavily employ the 70-centimeter segment for radio location applications. Frequencies in the 420 to 430 megahertz segment also can be used during space launches to send a flight self-destruct signal if a launch goes off course and poses danger to a populated area. The Commission's 2013 proposal, repeated in 2021, would permit use restricted to flight termination during launches by commercial space launch companies. Primary federal users also make use of 5650 to 5925 MHz for radio location applications, with channels used during launches for radar tracking. The Commission proposes to permit use by commercial entities similarly limited to use for radar tracking of launch vehicles. The Commission notes in its further notice of proposed rulemaking that since 2013, commercial entities have become established in space launch operations that were formerly the province of NASA. To support these commercial space ventures, entities such as the New Mexico Space Board Authority, the Virginia Commercial Space Flight Authority, and the Houston Airport System have established non-federal spaceports, the FCC said, noting that five bands, including 420 to 430 megahertz and 5650 to 5925 megahertz, are commonly used for communication with and tracking of launch vehicles. The Commission noted, however, that several commercial space launch providers indicated that they do not use either band for their operations. The FCC said that it has not granted an STA for the 420 to 430 megahertz band related to space launches, and in the recent past, only one operator obtained special temporary authorities to use the 5650 to 5925 megahertz band for a small number of launches. The Commission concluded that, given the limited current use of these bands during space launches by commercial space entities, we are not convinced that there is a need for new allocations for either band. Once again, comments are due on or before July 12, 2021. Reply comments are due on or before August 9, 2021.
The Volunteer Monitor Program is a joint initiative between ARRL and the FCC to enhance compliance in the amateur radio service. This is the updated May 2021 Volunteer Monitor Program report. Technician operators in Palm Bay and Hollywood, Florida, received advisory notices after making more than a dozen FT8 contacts on 40 and 20 meters. Technicians are not permitted to operate on 20 meters and have no data privileges on 40 meters. A licensee in El Cerrito, California, received an advisory notice concerning use of his 444.700 megahertz repeater for deliberate interference and unidentified transmissions. A general class licensee in Guanica, Puerto Rico, received an advisory notice after operating on 14.187 megahertz during a DX contest in May. General class licenses have no privileges below 14.225 megahertz on 20 meters. A general class licensee in Texas received a warning concerning deliberate interference broadcasting and failure to identify on 3.919 MHz and 3.922 MHz. The operator was informed that if such operation continued, the FCC would be requested to remove voice privileges from his license. A general class licensee in Slippery Rock, Pennsylvania, received an advisory notice for operation on 7.163 MHz. General class licenses are not permitted to operate below 7.175 MHz. A repeater station in Mission Viejo, California, was shut down after the operator received a notice that the repeater was being used for deliberate interference. A warning was issued to a licensee in Erie, Pennsylvania, for operation on 146.61 MHz and 146.682 MHz after the repeater licensee had requested in writing that the individual refrain from using the repeaters. The volunteer monitor program monitoring totals during April were 1,784 hours on the HF frequencies and 2,214 hours on VHF frequencies and above. The volunteer monitor coordinator had one meeting with the FCC, and one case was referred to the FCC for further action.
ARRL, the National Association for Amateur Radio, and MAG Instrument, the U.S. manufacturer of the Maglite flashlight, have announced they have formed a partnership based on common interests in equipping people to be prepared for emergencies and to serve their communities in extreme situations such as natural disasters. ARRL members expand the reservoir of trained operators and technicians in radio communications and radio technology and provide public service through the ARRL Amateur Radio Emergency Service. Maglite is the leading maker of U.S. manufactured high-quality flashlights that have a deserved reputation for toughness and durability. Amateur radio operators or hams help people in times of difficulty, often by supporting emergency communications where critical infrastructure is damaged and by aiding first responders' need to keep connected, said Anthony Maglica, founder, owner, and CEO of MAG Instrument Incorporated. We manufacture a product that has been used in public safety for over 40 years, and we are very supportive of the incredible dedication of radio amateurs, so culturally, this is a great alliance for both brands. ARRL is delighted that Maglite recognizes the service and skill of ARRL members. This partnership will help us introduce amateur radio to more people, said David Minster, NA2AA, ARRL CEO. MAG Instruments is creating a special laser-engraved Maglite product collection for ARRL, as well as offering their members special pricing on a select line of Maglite gear. In turn, those purchases raise funds to support ARRL's mission. Members can find details at www.arrl.org/benefits and by clicking Member Discounts in the left-hand navigation on that page. ARRL, headquartered in Newington, Connecticut, counts the majority of active radio amateurs in the U.S. among its ranks. Since its founding in 1914, ARRL and its members have advanced the art, science, and enjoyment of amateur radio.
A collection of more than 50 civil liberties groups, public interest organizations, and media outlets is asking for a fifth commissioner to be added to the Federal Communications Commission to make it a fully functional agency. FCC presently has four, with one seat vacant. The letter, dated June 11th, asked President Joe Biden to move forward with a nomination, allowing the FCC to tackle the issues before it regarding communications access and other matters. The FCC was created to be directed by five commissioners, appointed by the President and confirmed by the U.S. Senate. Each commissioner serves for 5 years, with one of the commissioners serving as the agency's chair. There's no immediate response from the letter to either the White House or the Federal Communications Commission.
Two hard-won privileges, extra power and access to a wider range of frequencies, now belong to the holders of a novice ham radio license in the Netherlands. These changes and the abolition of the age-based license restrictions took effect on the 18th of June. The Government Gazette recently published the changes to the so-called N registration, and Veron, the largest of Dutch amateur radio societies, promptly posted the news. According to a translation of that post, novice operators may now use the full 40-meter band between 7 and 7.2 megahertz and can transmit at 100 watts PEP on frequencies below 30 megahertz. They may use the 20-meter band between 14 and 14.25 megahertz, and they have gained access to the full 10-meter band between 28 and 29.7 megahertz. Their privileges on VHF and UHF have not changed. Another important change is the elimination of the minimum age for candidates wishing to sit for the novice or full exam. Previously, candidates had to be at least 12 and 14 years of age, respectively. The International Amateur Radio Union praised the abolition of these restrictions and on June 17th wrote on its website, "Today is an important day regarding youth and amateur radio in the Netherlands. To gain more young active radio hams, it is a must that this age group actually has the ability to obtain an amateur radio license."
Stuart Baker, Golf 3 Romeo X-Ray Quebec, submitted a Freedom of Information request to the UK regulator Ofcom to establish how many amateur radio licenses had been varied or revoked, covering the period 1st of May 2011 to the 1st of May 2021. Ofcom replied that they could confirm that in the relevant period they had not varied any amateur radio licenses. However, there had been two instances when they had revoked licenses. They had not varied or revoked any club or temporary reciprocal licenses. Concerning the two revocations, the first instance was in March 2013, when a full license was revoked because the license holder had breached Clause 7.3 of the Amateur Radio License Conditions. This license condition concerns ensuring that equipment does not cause undue interference. Ofcom stated that GDPR considerations meant that they could not reveal the call sign or identity of the person or persons concerned. In the second instance, on the 14th of December 2015, 529 amateur radio licenses were revoked because the holders of those licenses did not revalidate their licenses as required by Clause 6.3 of the relevant amateur radio license at the time. You can read the full Ofcom reply at www.whatdotheyknow.com. Search for request 1813773.
An experimental amateur radio beacon is making a 3,000-mile, 80-day journey across the Atlantic Ocean in a rowing boat, its second such trip this year, as the sole companion of French adventurer Gurek Soudé. The 1-watt WSPR beacon transmitting on 30 meters 9 times an hour is not there for Gurek's entertainment, according to Anthony, F4GOH, who built the beacon with Maurice, F6CIU, for their friend's adventure. It is designed to help keep track of him if his satellite phone fails. Gurek and his rowboat, Romaine, left Cape Cod in New England, bound for his hometown in Brittany, France, on Tuesday, the 15th of June. It was the second leg of his voyage, which began in December, when the young adventurer left the Canary Islands for St. Bart's in the Caribbean. A veteran sailor at 29, Gurek, in 2013, became the youngest person to sail to Alaska. During the first part of this latest trip crossing the Atlantic, he capsized twice en route to the Caribbean. Anthony said safety is the priority, adding that the beacon has been transmitting his French call sign.
35 years ago, an accident at the Chernobyl nuclear power plant in Ukraine caused two explosions that irradiated the surrounding area. It was one of the worst nuclear disasters in world history, and more than three decades later, the area around the plant is still an exclusion zone. The surrounding buildings, nuclear plant, and gigantic radar array called Duga 1, abandoned suddenly and left to decay over decades, are haunting reminders of the dangers of nuclear power and recognizable the world over because they keep appearing in popular movies and video games. Now, just in time for the disaster's 35th anniversary, Ukraine has declared that the enormous Duga 1 radar array is a protected cultural monument. You've probably seen Duga 1 before, even if you didn't know you were looking at a famous Soviet-era piece of radio equipment nestled deep in an irradiated forest. Almost 2,300 feet long and more than 450 feet high, the steel beams of the radar tower over the surrounding forest. From a distance, it appears to be a massive wall or the start of a cage. The Duga 1 is the setting for several Call of Duty maps, including a prominent place for a sniper's nest in the new 80s-themed Warzone map. It also appears as the final map in Call of Duty Black Ops Cold War and the Sosnovka military base in PlayerUnknown's Battleground. From the 1970s until the Chernobyl nuclear disaster, the Soviets' over-the-horizon radar Woodpecker caused severe interference in the amateur radio bands. The Association of Chernobyl Tour Operators first announced that Ukraine had made Duga 1 a protected heritage site on its Facebook page. Interfax, a Russian news service, later reported the official designation. Our heritage is not only the area around the power plant, but also the buildings located on its territory, Alexander Tukchenko, Ukraine's Minister of Culture and Information Policy, said in a Telegram thread about the announcement. So now we're working on identifying other objects that should be part of the list of monuments. Our goal is to prevent destruction when possible. When Duga 1 came online sometime in the mid-1970s, radio operators around the world noticed a strange signal coming from the forests of Ukraine. The system was so powerful, it disrupted some frequencies with an irritating thumping noise. Amateur radio operators dubbed the signal source the Russian Woodpecker because of the repeated tapping noise it pumped into amateur and shortwave radios.
The IARU Region 1 Workshop on the Future of Amateur Radio continued on June 12th with a focus on strengths, weaknesses, opportunities, and threats. This is known as SWOT. Member societies prepared a SWOT analyst. IARU Region 1 said, member societies expressed many common issues but also differences dependent on the particular environment in which the society operates and its geographical location. Strengths identified include strong community, while weaknesses include motivation and capability within the amateur community. Growing the pool of potential licenses was viewed as an opportunity, while increasing noise levels was among the threats. IARU Region 1 President Don Beatty, G3BJ, chaired the June 12th gathering, which involved some 34 IARU Region 1 member societies. I am pleased that we now have the program underway and have completed the first step in our work, Beatty said. The overall program is an important process to take an honest look at amateur radio today and refocus us on the priorities for the future. Beatty said that building on the self-reflection questionnaire that member societies considered last year, Region 1 now has a baseline of strengths, weaknesses, opportunities, and threats looking forward. Our next steps will be to consider where we would like amateur radio to be in, say, 10 years' time and to work through the steps and the programs that will help take it there, said Beatty. We are at a time of enormous change in the environment for amateur radio, and this represents a big challenge for IARU and its member societies. With the commitment of our member societies through this workshop program, I believe we can rise to that challenge. IARU Region 1 said, workshop participants are now considering the output for the June 12th session and formulating discussion points regarding the future shape of amateur radio ahead of the final workshop session this October in Serbia.
Over the weekend of June the 19th and 20th, there was a major outbreak of noctilucent clouds, known as NLCs, which broke free of the Arctic Circle and spread across most of Europe. The blue clouds, made of frosted meteor smoke, were photographed south of Madrid, nearly breaking the all-time record for low-latitude sightings. This means that NLCs could soon be coming to you. Spaceweather.com said that for most of their history, the clouds have been found mainly near the Arctic Circle, but now they are spreading. The record low latitude to date was set in June 2019, when the clouds appeared near Los Angeles at 34 degrees north. NLCs are Earth's highest clouds. They form when summertime wisps of water vapor rise to the edge of space about 83 kilometers high and crystallize around disintegrated meteoroids. When you see one, you're literally seeing a cloud of frosted meteor smoke. If you want to try spotting NLCs, look west 30 to 60 minutes after sunset or before sunrise, when the sun is just below the horizon. If you see luminous blue-white tendrils spreading out across the sky, you may have spotted a noctilucent cloud.
The International Amateur Radio Union represented the amateur service at a recent International Telecommunication Union virtual meeting on the topic of wireless power transmission, attended by some 350 delegates. ITU Working Party 1A Working Group was of most relevance to IARU, covering the topic of wireless power transmission. The focus is on WPT's impact on the radio spectrum. IARU's contribution centered on proposing amendments to material submitted by other delegations and a new annex that documents measurements of typical amateur signal levels, comparing these to test data from the U.S. on non-beam WPT emission levels and to suggested limits. Most of the discussions on the detail were resolved with a degree of compromise, and the latest drafts will be attached to the chairman's report for the meeting, IARU Region 1 reported. Remaining technical issues include whether e-field antennas are as susceptible to WPT electric vehicle emissions as H-field antennas, the true noise levels in residential areas, with WPT developers claiming that WPT emissions will not be significantly above the now elevated noise level. In terms of e-field sensitivity to WPT emissions, the proposed work plan submitted by IARU to the European Commission for WPT electric vehicle tests in the Joint Research Center included proper E and H field measurements. IARU member society DARC in Germany has made good progress with the rollout of its ENAMS automated noise measurement system, and IARU is now able to draw heavily on that data, IARU Region 1 said. The WPT emissions document has been under discussion for some time. Here, there is no agreement yet on whether this should be a report or a recommendation, and the work has been carried forward to the next meeting in November 2021. Discussion on so-called beam wireless power transmission covered a range of issues, including amendments to the proposed frequencies. None are below 800 MHz. Sadly, many proposed frequencies fall in spectrum which the amateur service shares with other services, the IARU said. However, given the nature of the technology and the directivity of amateur antennas in these frequency ranges, the prospect of coexistence seems quite good. The IARU has provided extensive input on the potential impact of radio communications resulting from spurious emissions from WPT devices. Given the planned density of WPT systems for electric vehicles operating in the 79 to 90 kHz range, widespread interference could occur to amateur service stations in the vicinity of WPT systems.
And now with the latest technology news and commentary from Petaluma, California, This Week in Amateur Radio is proud to present Leo Laporte.
You got Leo right now, your personal tech guy. In a continuing series of attempting to figure out what the heck is going on in technology. What the heck is going on? Let's see. State of California has launched a digital vaccine verification system. It's not exactly the most technologically sophisticated thing in the world. State of Massachusetts has an app. Actually, there's been some consternation about the app because there are some Android users that say, Google just installed this without asking. There's an app on my phone, the Massachusetts State app. I didn't do it. That's not probably not a good thing for Google to do. Google and Apple both on their phones have a setting that you have to opt into saying, I want COVID notifications. But now, really, it's not so much that I want to be notified I've been exposed. Now what you'd like is some way to show your phone or whatever. So you could get into a theater or a restaurant or go on a trip and that kind of thing. So California has a system where you go to a website, you enter your name and your birthday. That's all they need, apparently, and your phone number. And then they send you a link. You also have to give them a PIN. And then they send you a link. myvaccinerecord.cdph.ca.gov. I did it last night and never heard of me, so I'm not sure how this is going to work. Actually, that's a cause for concern, isn't it? Because if others are using this database, it'll look like I never got vaccinated, but I certainly did. And I have a card. I have a paper card I can bring with me. So, I don't know what's going on. Apparently, what you'll get is a QR code that you can show people. It says, I'm vaccinated, and then I guess they'll accept it. Let me just try this again. Maybe it was last night that they didn't know. I don't know. Maybe they were just getting that all set up. It was broken. I hope so. Because I, you know, all it is a picture you hold on your phone, which is really as good as anything, right? This is tricky because, well, there's for all sorts of reasons. If it's just a picture, anybody could, you know, use Photoshop, edit it, put it on their phone, even if they didn't get a, there's somewhat of an honor system here. You didn't get a vaccine. I don't see any reason you couldn't, you know, put this on your phone with your name and birthday and, you know, borrow it from somebody. Undoubtedly, somebody will put theirs up on the internet and you could just use that. That's the warning that went out when those vaccine cards went out. Is don't put it on the internet. People will steal it. People are people. People game the system. That's the phrase I'm using. They game the system. I guess it's always happened, but boy, in the internet era, it's happened in spades. The gaming the system is when you take something and you decide and you modify how you interact with it in such a way to your benefit. So hackers, that's what they do. They game the system. That's what a spear phishing email is. It comes from the boss, except it's not really from the boss, but they gamed it, right, so that you would believe it. It's a problem all over the place, gaming the system. It makes it very hard to do stuff online, whether it's voting or vaccine cards, because there is a certain percentage of the population that takes great pleasure in gaming the system, even if it maybe is a little sketch. You know, this may be dishonorable would be a good phrase for it. Some people don't care. They don't mind. So then we have to implement all these extreme measures to make it work. For instance, there's a company called ID.me that is being used by unemployment bureaus across the nation. The problem is that unemployment fraud, according to ID.me, now these are a little, this is there, it's a commercial enterprise, so they want you to think it's a problem, but they say $400 billion a year in unemployment fraud. So companies are using ID.me with face recognition and official documents to confirm that you are who you say you are. But ID.me is apparently not working for people, which means even people who want their legitimate unemployment benefits aren't getting them. This is a story from Vice.com. In Colorado, benefit recipients who had prior to this no problem establishing their identity, now that ID.me uses it, were suddenly rejected and went months without receiving payments they were eligible for. Also used in Florida, North Carolina, Pennsylvania, Arizona, other states. So that's the problem. People game the system, and then you have to bring in this draconian system to kind of stop it, and then that's a problem. And oy. let's see, what else is in the news? Are we ready for Windows 11? It's coming out this week. Thursday morning, 11 a.m. Get it? Thursday morning, Microsoft will announce the next version of Windows. So this week it came out, you know, it was leaked. There's a whole conspiracy about, was Windows 11 leaked by Microsoft to lower expectations? Maybe Microsoft was worried people were getting their hopes up about the, quote, new version of Windows and said they wanted to damp down the excitement. Or, but I don't think that's the case. Or maybe it just leaked out, which things happen. You know, a big reason for Windows 11, some would say, the reason for Windows 11 is to get people to buy new computers. In the Windows world, you check yourself on this. You don't get a new version of Windows until you get a new computer. You just run with the Windows it came with. And then eventually, and that's Microsoft's been fighting that. That's why they gave away Windows 10 for free for a year. They wanted everybody to upgrade. I think a lot of us did. But it wasn't our habit. The habit was, I'll use Windows 7 until I get a new computer. And it'll come with whatever the current version is. And that's what I'll do. So Microsoft's now thinking, well, but gosh, we haven't updated Windows in a long time. Maybe if we put out Windows 11, people will go to the store to buy a new computer. They're doing it for the PC industry. PC industry had a banner year thanks to COVID last year. Best year almost ever. But that's because so many people went out and bought extra computers for the kids who had to use them for school. And maybe they needed a better computer for work, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So it ended up being that was... That last year was a good year, but now everybody's very nervous that 2021 is going to be a terrible year because that's what happens. Everybody goes out and buys computers in one year. The next year going to be kind of slow, right? That's how life works. So Microsoft's going to do something to try to make that better, like put out a new version of Windows. So I've looked at the, you know, the pre-release, the leaked version, which as I, was about to say probably came from a manufacturer who got it so they could, you know, next week say, now with Windows 11. They've changed some things. For instance, and I, you know, this is, it's all, okay, first let me say this, all cosmetic. Under the hood, as far as we can tell, it's still Windows 10. It's the same Windows. So what they change is the look and feel. But, you know, whenever you do that, people freak out, right? So are you going to freak out because all of a sudden the start menu, you know how you've got the start menu and all those little icons following that, you know, on the left there? Starting with Windows 11, it's going to be in the middle, centered, kind of like a Macintosh. I think it looks nice. You know, I think it makes sense, especially as screens get bigger and bigger, to move your mouse all the way to the left. It's bad enough you can move to the bottom. Now you got to move all the way to the bottom and the left just to get to the start menu. I think most people who use Windows a lot just don't even use the mouse to do that. They hit the Windows key. There's the menu. They type the first few letters and hit return, and that's that. Do you do that? Do you know that? See, that's kind of one of those things that people who use it a lot go, oh, here's the trick, and somebody tells you, and you go, oh, I'm never going to do it any other way. But now the unified, simplified, centered start menu going to look a little different. Instead of square corners, they're slightly rounded. You know, I look at this and go, so what, big deal? Minor changes. But that can throw people. In fact, businesses are saying, we're not going to go to Windows 11 because we don't want to throw people. We don't want to retrain people to move the mouse to the middle or instead of the left. Anyway, we'll see this. Windows 11, Microsoft will articulate a clear vision for why they wanted to change all this. But just between you and me, read between the lines, the clear vision is we got to sell more computers. This year's going to be terrible otherwise. Part of the problem is you can have people demanding them, but if you can't make them because of chip shortages, that doesn't matter. There will be a new Windows Store, Microsoft says. We haven't seen that in the leaked version. So new app stores coming as well. And they have lots of new sounds and really pretty wallpaper. It's all about the pretty wallpaper. The Apple has always got this nice wallpaper. Microsoft says, we need pretty wallpaper. So now, pretty wallpaper. Yeah, it's pretty. Looks more like a Mac. But I can tell already there'll be howls of pain and outrage because they take the start menu and the icons to the right of it and they move it to the middle. They've centered it. And I know people who have that muscle memory. You go down the lower left corner to click the start menu. They're going to go, oh, no, they moved it to the middle. So I'm going to say this preemptively. There's a switch. You can put it back on the left. You can put it anywhere you want. I think it makes sense in the middle, if you think about it, because that's less of a distance to travel with your mouse. And do you use the mouse to click the start menu? I feel like that's the bunny slope for Windows users. It's using take the mouse and move it all the way down there in the left corner and click it. And that seems like that's just hit the Windows key. The whole thing pops up. You type the first few letters and that's it. You're in. Yeah, that's a tip, right? Is there going to be a charge? We don't know. Will it cost you? See, I think that's a question Windows users don't ask too much. Enthusiasts do, but most normal Windows users just buy a new computer and get whatever Windows is on it. And so I think what Microsoft will announce, we don't know, but I think on Thursday what they'll announce is, and now starting, you know, June 30th or whatever, all new PCs will come with Windows 11 on it. And that's how most people get whatever version of Windows. It just comes with a new PC. It's the enthusiasts who actually say, I want to upgrade. I want Windows 11 on my old PC. But I don't think that's why Microsoft is doing this. They'll keep Windows 10 around for a while. They're doing Windows 11 to get people to buy new PCs. So I'm going to guess they're going to charge you. But I don't think they'll charge $100. I'm going to guess $35. That's just just enough money so Microsoft, you know, can say, look, we're going to make some money on this. And this, but it's just low enough that the enthusiasts who really want to, I want the latest. I have to have the latest. It's got to be new. It's got to be fresh. They're going to pay $35. So that's my prediction. But we don't know. We don't know. It's not that Microsoft makes the bulk of its money from people buying upgrades to Windows. They gave away Windows 10 for a year. So maybe they'll do that for Windows 11. It's not a huge profit center for them. They make money on it because the PC manufacturers pay them. We call it the Windows tax. When you buy a Windows PC, some amount of that, we don't know exactly what, somewhere between $25 and $40 goes to Microsoft. That's to pay for Windows. You don't give it away to the PC makers. No, sirree. So this will be, we'll find out you know, details will be revealed on Thursday. I guess it's exciting. We haven't had a new version of Windows in some time. So I guess it's good. It's good. We'll get excited about it. And I'll certainly talk about it next week. And you know what? If I have to pay for it, I guess I'll get it. I'll have to pay for it. If I get it for free, I'll be great. Anyway, I'm glad you were here, and I'm here, and I'll be here next week, and I hope you'll come by and bring your friends, too, as we talk high tech. Leo Laporte, the tech guy.
Are you ready for another trip into amateur radio history? I'm Bill Continelli, W2XOY, and I'll be back in a moment with another edition of the Ancient Amateur Archives, here on This Week in Amateur Radio. WARC 79 was over, and amateur radio came out ahead. We kept all of our major HF, VHF, and UHF bands and received three new HF allocations, a 50 kHz shared band at 10 MHz, and two new exclusive 100 kHz segments at 18 and 24 MHz. These were the first new HF bands since 1947, when we were allocated the 15-meter band. The only downside was the time element. It would take about 2 years to actually receive 10 MHz, and up to 9 years for 18 and 24 MHz. Amateurs, however, had waited until 1952 to get 15 meters. We would gladly wait again, especially for 200 kHz of worldwide HF spectrum. Other legal and regulatory news dominated the amateur world at the beginning of 1980. The FCC proposed a new sideband-only CB band from 27.41 MHz, just above CB channel 40, to 27.54 MHz. For this new CB allocation, the FCC proposed removing the 155-mile contact limit, thus allowing DX contacts, as well as permitting VFOs. A non-technical test would be required for access to the CB-SSB band. Reaction, as you might guess, was strong and divided. HF outbanders, who worked the 10.5-meter band, were in favor, unlike the 220 MHz Class E CB proposal a few years back. They could work skip on this new band, or should we say it would legitimize their present operations. The ARRL and the amateur community were strongly opposed. Many letters in QST pointed out the intrusion of the illegal operations on 10.5-meter band into the bottom part of our 10-meter band. In the end, the proposal was abandoned. The freebanders and outbanders continue to operate the 27.41 to 28 MHz segment to this day. In January 1980, the FCC approved ASCII, which at that time was described as an encoding system for digital transmissions that is compatible with most personal computers. Packet radio had received the official government blessing. Wayne Green, W2NSD Portable 1, in a 73 magazine editorial, called the FCC action asinine because it only allowed 300 baud. Wayne pointed out that 1200 baud was the norm in telephone operations and speeds as fast as, wait for it, 9600 baud would soon be possible. Novices and technicians got good news in 1980. They could now operate in Canada. In the past, they were not allowed to operate north of the border because Canada had no equivalent license. Since Canada now had a VHF license, that opened the RF door to all novices and technicians. No reciprocal permit was required. In 1980, Congress is considering a bill to allow 10-year licenses and the authorization of volunteer examiners. The ARRL is watching this bill closely and will keep the amateur community informed. Hams have been looking forward to the launch of AMSAT Oscar Phase 3. Unfortunately, on May 23, 1980, the launch vehicle failed and it dumped into the ocean. In 1980, the Ancient Amateur Archives was 16 years into the future. I started this series in 1996. So, in 1980, what was a history-starved ham to do? Don't worry, just pick up 73 magazine. Eric Schalkhauser, W9CI, was writing The History of Ham Radio as a series in 73 magazine. Also in 73 magazine, the CB to 10 meter series was still going strong, showing how to convert those obsolete 23 channel CB rigs to 10 meters and, in some cases, 10 meter FM. In 1980, what rigs were on the market? In the field of 2 meter handhelds, the Tempo S1, the first synthesized handheld, was facing some stiff competition. Kenwood introduced the TR-2400, and Yaesu brought out the FT-207R. Both were priced at just $395. ICOM unveiled the IC-2A and the IC-2AT. Prices started at just $200 with no NiCADs or touchtone pad to $270 fully equipped. In response, Tempo dropped the price of the S1 to $260. If you can't afford a synthesized HT, buy a discontinued crystal-controlled rig. The high-gain, 1-watt, 6-channel HT is just $88. The Yaesu FT-202R, a 1-watt, 6-channel unit, which looks just like the FT-207R, is only $125. Pace is leaving the ham market and has its remaining 2-meter handhelds on closeout for less than $125. Inflation has increased prices 300% since 1980. Figure out the prices of these radios in today's dollars. Finally, in 1980, did you get bashed? Did you buy the final exam? Will you ever admit to it? What's the controversy? In 1980, Dick Bash, KL7IHP, published a series of books entitled The Final Exam. They were nicknamed the Bash Books. The actual test questions and multiple choice answers were reproduced verbatim as they appeared on the FCC Technician, General, Advanced, and Amateur Extra exams. Remember, in 1980, the FCC exam question pool was not published. The FCC had a general syllabus of rules, regulations, and technical data covered on each exam. The ARRL license manual discussed these topics in detail, but no one had published the actual questions and answers until Dick Bash came along. How did he get the questions? Simple. He would go down to the FCC examination site, stand outside the door, and question the applicants as they came out. Cooperative hams, or would-be hams, gave him the questions and multiple-choice answers that appeared on their tests. Later, as the books began to sell in numbers, applicants would mail him the questions and answers that were on the tests. The books were popular, selling at a rate of 1,000 per month in 1980. Dick Bash claimed his operation was 100% legal. He said that since the questions were available via a Freedom of Information Act request, they weren't classified and could be published. He further stated that he was justified in publishing the final exam because the syllabus and license manuals out there did not adequately prepare applicants for the exams. Indeed, FCC records showed that the failure rate at some exam sessions was 69%. Less than 1 out of 3 passed. This was before the volunteer exam program. FCC exams were given at the 20 field offices nationwide and at quarterly, semi-annual, and annual examination sites. If you failed, it might be 3 months or more before you could retake the test. The ARRL and the FCC fought back. QST refused to run ads for the final exam. The FCC began rewording and changing the questions on the exams to thwart those who had memorized the earlier questions. Dick Bash claimed that the FCC used coercion to pressure magazines and distributors not to advertise or sell the final exam. This battle went on until 1984, when the Volunteer Examiner Program was instituted and the FCC released the question pool to the public. Dick Bash ceased his operation. Did he win in principle? You decide. In our next installment, we are going to stay in 1980 and look at 4 unique public service activities in which amateur radio played an important role. Sadly, in one event, 2 hams lost their lives. So until then, turn on your TRS-80 and copy all those new packet signals. This is Bill Continelli, W2XOY, for This Week in Amateur Radio.
It's time to take a look at the propagation forecast on this field day weekend. Tad Cook, K7RA in Seattle, reports that average daily sunspot numbers were down this reporting week, which covers June 17th through the 23rd, essentially unchanged from last week's reading of 13.9. The average daily solar flux increased from 75.2 to 79.3. Geomagnetic indicators were also quieter. The average planetary A index declined from 9.6 to 5.3. The average middle latitude A index dropped from 9.7 to 6.1. So let's take a look ahead. The predicted solar flux is 82 on June 25th through July 1st, then 80 and 78 on July 2nd and 3rd, 75 on July 4th through the 7th, 78 on July 8th through the 11th, 75 on July 12th through the 16th, and 78 on July 17th through the 22nd. Looking at the predicted planetary A index now, it will be 5 on June 25th through July 3rd, 12 on July 4th, 5 on July 5th through the 8th, 8 on July 9th through the 10th, 5, 15, and 12 on July 11th through the 13th, respectively, and 5 on July 14th through the 20th. Sunspot group 2833 is about to rotate over our sun's western horizon, but TAD sees a promising activity around and beyond the eastern horizon when viewing the stereo mission images. Also check the solar monitor site to see this emerging activity. Also take note that the 2300 UTC June 22nd solar flux reading from the Dominion Astrophysical Observatory in Canada, the official solar flux for that day was the noon reading, which was 80.8 at 2000 UTC.
Time now for the AMSAT report. A quick note about Field Day, which, as we noted, may already have happened by the time you hear this. Paul, N8HM, has prepared a quick primer at www.amsat.org. Scroll down to Satellites Likely to be Active on Field Day 2021. Field Day or any other time, do not try to use AO91 when it is in eclipse, only when it is in sunlight. In other words, when you're in sunlight. As reported earlier, the ISS will be in crossband repeater mode for Field Day, but will be switching back to packet afterward. The ISS Columbus module and service module stations will be off the air on July 2nd when the Progress is docking. And a final note, VP2V/K3TRM will be operating July 4th through the 17th from Tortola, British Virgin Islands on 40 through 6 meters SSB and digital, as well as satellite. The AMSAT report comes to us courtesy of Bruce Page, KK5DO.
United Press International recently carried a story about the forthcoming launch of WoodSat CubeSat, which is made out of wood and carries an amateur radio payload. It is hoped that the satellite, which is part of a public relations initiative by Finland's UPM Plywood Company, will be launched towards the end of the year. WoodSat has attracted attention from corporations and media around the world and elicited cooperation from the European Space Agency. WoodSat is built by Arctic Astronautics, which normally focuses on tiny educational satellite kits for schools. The Finnish company UPM Plywood provides high-quality wood for the craft and covers the launch cost. WoodSat also offers a unique chance to transmit messages around the globe by bouncing a radio signal off the satellite. To use the feature, radio operators must have 432 MHz equipment, that's the 70cm amateur band. The WoodSat team have applied for IARU satellite frequency coordination. And you can read the full story at www.upi.com and search for Science News.
W1AW/KL7 will be in Alaska to serve as the ARRL headquarters station for the International Amateur Radio Union HF World Championship competition on July 10th and the 11th. To provide radio amateurs the opportunity to work W1AW, as well as the state of Alaska, the use of W1AW/KL7 has been authorized from 0000 UTC on July 8th to 2359 UTC on July 13th. NU1AW, the IARU headquarters station, will be active as NU1AW/5 in a multi-operator distributed operation from the ARRL West Gulf Division, Texas and Oklahoma. NU1AW/5 will be on CW and sideband, 1.8 through 28 MHz. W1AW/KL7 and NU1AW will be on the only U.S. headquarters stations active. IARU President Tim Allum, VE6SH, will be giving out the Administrative Council Multiplier, along with the new IARU Secretary Joel Harrison, W5ZN. Here's a growing list of IARU headquarters stations, courtesy of Bob, N6TV, and Joe, OZOJ.
The amateur radio on Shuttle, Mir, and International Space Station Slow Scan Television event started on June the 21st and will continue until 18:30 UTC on June the 26th. Transmissions are on 145.800 MHz FM using SSTV mode PD120. The ARRL team will be transmitting slow scan television images continuously from June the 21st to the 26th. The images will be related to some of the amateur radio activities that have occurred on the Space Shuttle, Mir Space Station, and the International Space Station. Those that recently missed the opportunity during the limited period of the Moscow Aviation Institute transmissions earlier in June should have numerous chances over the six-day period to capture many, if not all, of the 12 images being broadcast. Check the ARRL SSTV blog for the latest information and a link to the SSTV gallery. Go to ARRL-sstv.blogspot.com. The signal should be receivable on a handheld with a quarter-wave whip. If your rig has selectable FM filters, try the wider filter for 25 kHz channel spacing. Some people have even successfully decoded images by downloading an SSTV app to their smartphone and holding it up in front of the rig's loudspeaker. You can get predictions for the ISS pass times at www.amsat.org/track, and there's lots of useful SSTV info and links at amsat-uk.org/beginners.
On the 60th anniversary of the Antarctic Treaty, declaring the frozen continent devoted to peace and study of science, the continent was transformed, if only for a short while, by radio. On Midwinter's Day, the 21st of June, those working in the trio of British Antarctic Territory research stations exchanged traditional gifts and then enjoyed the warmth of the BBC Midwinter broadcast on BBC World Service. In a spot on the planet that has not seen sun since the middle of May, Midwinter's Day marks the turning point, and the comforting waves of radio will soon be followed by rays of sunshine once more. Jerry Gilliam, station leader at the King Edward Point Research Station in South Georgia, said the radio and the celebrations have already brought some light into their lives. He said, "We'll get messages and photos from every station, and there's a sense of wider community and camaraderie with these people we'll never meet, but have something in common with."
The nationwide emergency alert system in the U.S. is in for some changes as a result of some moves by the Federal Communications Commission. In the U.S., the FCC has adopted new rules to improve the country's emergency alert system by creating a new class of alerts, while also providing ways to more efficiently report false emergency notifications. The nationwide alert system uses TV, mobile phone, and radio to get the word out about disasters. The FCC's latest move comes in response to a false notification in January of 2018 that sent out a message that Hawaii was targeted by an incoming missile, indicating that this is not a drill. The false alert spurred hearings and an examination of steps that could be taken to prevent such a recurrence. The agency's move comes a few weeks before the nationwide test of the emergency alert system and wireless emergency alerts to take place on August 11th. The FCC is also acting as hurricane and wildfire season have arrived in the U.S., where pandemic precautions are still in place in varying degrees.
On the website www.radioites.de this week, there's an interesting article about the last French broadcast station still on longwave, using 234 kHz AM. After Radio France, Europe 1 and RMC stopped their broadcasts on longwave, station RTL has been the only broadcaster since 2020 that still uses this frequency range for France. The operators of the channel in Luxembourg are optimistic that they'll be able to continue into the foreseeable future. The transmitter of one of the closed down stations, the one in Alloy in central France, is ironically still in operation. It now transmits the French time signal service. On 162 kHz, broadcast programming ceased at the end of 2016. The signal remained on 162 kHz, but it was just a silent carrier. The French regulator, ANFR, now pays for the operating costs. The long-wave transmitter in southern France, which was abandoned by the broadcaster RMC in March 2020, is no longer active, but it is in working condition, and there's hope it might be rented to a broadcaster again. The situation is completely different with the Europe 1 transmitter in Saarland, which was shut down at the end of 2019. The mast was brought down in October 2020. But the Bideweiler transmitter site in Luxembourg is still in regular use on 234 kHz. Since 1972, it has been used by the French broadcaster RTL and consists of three masts, each 290 metres high. The station uses a 1.5 million watt transistor transmitter from Berlin, known as a type TRAM. At the nearby transmitter site in Junglinster, a shortwave system rebroadcasted the RTL signal, but this ceased in 1991. The shortwave transmitters were reactivated in 2003 in an ambitious attempt to use the shortwave bands with new AM digital broadcasts. After these efforts only met with a very subdued response, broadcasting ended in 2011 without a digital sound ever being heard. For many years, RTL Radio reported over 10 million listeners to its long-wave service, but in recent years, this was reported to have fallen to 600,000. You may be old enough to remember Radio Luxembourg on 1440 kHz medium wave. Well, that was switched off at the end of 2015, and the transmitter's masts near Marnac were demolished in February 2016. At the end of its life, the Marnac station carried China Radio International for 10 hours every day. You can read the full article by Kai Ludwig at www.radioeins.de, and our thanks go to Mike Terry for spotting this story.
Foundations of Amateur Radio. Sometimes when you head into uncharted territory, you've got to laugh at yourself from time to time. Last weekend, I participated in a contest, something I enjoy doing, as you might recall. To simplify the process of setting up in a vehicle, I'd proposed a bold plan to save space and reduce complexity. I was anxious about reducing the amount of technology because I'd come up with a plan to use a paper log to track my contest contacts. I had visions of operating for the best part of 24 hours and making hundreds of contacts. This was based on the fact that in 2016 I'd done this same contest on my own and made 138 contacts and scored 18,221 points, having moved 17 times. I'd also done the contest in 2018, and for reasons I don't recall, I made one contact over 8 hours. That, right there, should have been a warning sign that I might not quite get the result I'd been fearful of. Blissfully unaware of the adventure that was unfolding, after driving to the first location, I called CQ for the better part of an hour. Then I called some more. When I was done with that, I called CQ more. 90 minutes in, I made my first contact. That pretty much set the pattern for the next 9 hours. At one point, we feared that the radio had packed up, but then I made a 2,900-kilometre contact with the other side of the country, between me in Perth in VK6 and Catherine Victor Kilo 7 Golf Hotel in Tasmania. Around 5 p.m. we packed up, having moved locations 6 times, making 8 contacts and claiming 64 points, having worked 3 of the 6 states I heard. Talk about overblown fears. Looking back, even documenting 138 contacts on paper doesn't seem nearly as daunting after the fact, but that's for another day. I did learn some other things too. I was worried about logging the band correctly, since using a computer that's not connected to the radio requires an extra step when you change band. Using paper, the issue wasn't the band, it was remembering to record the time. We didn't have the opportunity to test all the gear before the contest. I was bringing in some extra audio splitters, which didn't work with the setup we had. Testing beforehand would have revealed that. We knew that there was a risk associated with not testing before and decided that in the scheme of things, it didn't matter. And we were right. It didn't. We hadn't much planned for food and pit stops, but having a GPS and an internet connection solved all those issues almost invisibly. Of course, that wouldn't work in an unpopulated area, but we were well inside the metropolitan area of a big city. Well, Perth. Using a headset worked great, though it didn't have a monitoring feature, so my voice got louder and louder, and Thomas, Victor Kilo 6 Victor Charlie Romeo, who took on the tasks of navigating and driving, became deafer and deafer as the day progressed. I keep coming back to wanting a portable voice keyer, a device that you can record your CQ call into, and then at the press of a button play it back, so you don't lose your voice whilst calling CQ hour after hour. The challenge seems to be that you need to find a way to incorporate it into the existing audio chain so it doesn't introduce interference. Winning a contest requires contacts, and that can only happen if there are other participants. This time around, there didn't seem to be that many on air making noise. I think I heard a grand total of 13 stations. Some of that was due to propagation conditions, which were nothing like I'd ever heard before. But perhaps if I stick around for another solar cycle, that too will become familiar. Atrocious is one word that comes to mind. Continuing our learning, the weather, not just space weather, actual Earth weather, snow, rain, hail, and in our case, sun. Neither of us thought to bring a hat, since the forecast was for intermittent rain. We had no rain, instead had the opportunity to bask in the winter sun. Yes, it's winter here in Oz, when it's summer in Europe. As it happens, our winter temperatures are like your summer ones, but I'll leave it for you to confirm that for yourself. Finally, we have a local phenomenon in VK6. When the sun goes down, the 40-meter band comes alive with the sounds of Indonesia. Among the radio amateurs are plenty of pirate stations with massive AM transmitters enjoying the conditions, chatting, chanting, and whatever else comes to voice. Not conducive to being on air and making noise, but as far as I can tell, not commonly heard outside of VK6. That said, the Indonesian radio amateur community must have the patience of saints, putting up with the interference that their non-licensed countrymen cause on a daily basis. My hat off to you. As I've said all along, this radio thing is about getting on air and having fun, and I can tell you, we did. What did you get up to? I'm Ono, Victor Kilo 6, Foxtrot Lima, Alpha Bravo.
The Youngsters on the Air contest first round is complete, and the claimed results have been posted on the YOTA website, with final results coming soon. Worldwide participation was very good. In the YOTA class categories, more than 100 were from contesters as young as 7 years old, and 3 entered as shortwave listeners. There were more than 600 entries of participants above the age of 25, with the oldest participant at age 87. The next round will be on July 18th, 1000 to 2159 UTC. The event includes a 6-hour category. This is a change in date from the previously announced July 17th. Everyone in the ham radio community can take part. It takes place 3 times per year and only lasts 12 hours, said International Amateur Radio Union Region 1 Youth Working Group Chair Philip Springer, DK6SP. The event includes 8 entry categories. Operation is on 80, 40, 20, 15, and 10 meters, CW or SSB. The contest exchange is the operator's age, and different ages also serve as multipliers during the contest. Also, the younger the operator, the more points per contact. Visit the YOTA contest page for more information. If the FAQ doesn't address your particular concern, you can email the Youngsters on the Air Contest Committee.
The 13th running of the popular 13 Colonies special event will take place July 1st through the 8th UTC. A series of one-by-one call signs, K2A through K2M, will represent each of the original colonies in North America. The event begins at 1300 UTC on July 1st and concludes at 0400 UTC on July 8th. Listen for bonus stations TM13COL, GB13COL, and WM3PEN, the last call sign in recognition of William Penn, Pennsylvania's namesake. Last year, the special event's 13 stations made 202,000 contacts.
SAQ, the call sign of the vintage Alexanderson alternator transmitter in Grimeton, Sweden, will conduct its annual Alexanderson Day transmission on Sunday, July 4th. The CW transmission will be on 17.2 kHz CW. The Alexanderson-Grimmington Association is planning for two broadcasts from the circa 1924 Alexanderson alternator. Startup and tuning for the first SAQ transmission will take place at 0830 UTC, with a message transmission to follow at 0900 UTC. Startup and tuning for the second SAQ transmission will take place at 1130 UTC, with a message transmission to follow at 1200 UTC. Both events will be live streamed on the Alexander SAQ Grimmington Association YouTube channel.
It was announced in January that two chess CubeSats set for launch in 2022 would carry amateur radio linear transponders. The project sponsors announced back on June 10th, however, that neither chess satellite would include an amateur radio payload. The chess project management, citing funding constraints, had to move the project towards a purely scientific program using a commercial CubeSat platform, which has less space for the planned amateur radio transponder. Chess project management will also not use frequencies allocated to the amateur satellite service, but will use Earth exploration or experimental UHF and X-band frequencies. The ham community, which assured the funding of the transponder, was very disappointed by this decision but must accept it, the project team said in a news release. Such projects always carry risks of one partner changing its mind, and that's what happened here. Many thanks to all who have actively supported the transponder project, especially the AMSAT UK and AMSAT NL team.
The Daily DX has reported that the 3Y Oscar Juliet DXpedition team is still hoping to have a go at the island in 2023. The DXpedition team had planned to travel to Bouvet via the RV Braveheart, owned by Niger Jolly, K6NRJ. Since the cancellation of 3Y Oscar Juliet, we have been working closely with Niger Jolly to form a new plan. With a new owner of Braveheart and a revised payment plan that enables Niger Jolly to continue managing Braveheart and will keep it available for DXpeditions for years to come, said the announcement from the DXpedition co-leader, Paul Ewing, N6PSE. We're working out the details of this plan and hope to have some very positive news very soon. We have not given up. The Intrepid DX Group announced earlier this month that it has canceled its long-anticipated DXpedition to Bouvet. Jolly told the DXpedition that the Braveheart was being sold and he was canceling its contract for the 3Y Oscar Juliet voyage.
Here's this week's listing of upcoming ARRL Learning Network webinars, which are a members-only benefit. To register, check on upcoming webinars, and to view previously recorded sessions, please visit the ARRL Learning Network webinar webpage. Antenna Zoning, special six-part webinar series. Antenna Zoning for the Radio Amateur. Parts 1 through 4 have been archived and are available for playback. Part 5, More Laws, is scheduled for Monday, June 28th at 2 p.m. Eastern. That's 1800 UTC. And Part 6, The Hearing, is scheduled for Wednesday, June 30th at 2 p.m. Eastern. That's 1800 UTC. Designing Coiled Coax or Ugly Balance. John Portune, W6NBC, is scheduled for Tuesday, July 8th, 2021 at 8 p.m. Eastern. That's 0000 UTC on Friday, July 9th. Coiled coax balance is a familiar term in the world of ham radio, but not many hams know how to design them for maximum efficiency. The internet offers many designs and can be confusing, so this presentation will help you learn the main function of a balun by calculating and not guessing at the amount of coil needed. It will also cover self-resonance and frequency limitations. ARRL members may register for upcoming presentations and view previously recorded Learning Network webinars. ARRL-affiliated radio clubs may also use the recordings as presentations for club meetings, mentoring new and current hams, and discussing amateur radio topics. The ARRL Learning Network schedule is subject to change.
Amateur radio on the International Space Station, ARIS, is the group that puts together special amateur radio contacts between students around the globe and crew members with ham radio licenses on the International Space Station. At the end of June, there will be a multi-point telebridge contact via amateur radio between the ISS and students from three schools in France. Students will take turns asking their questions of astronaut Thomas Pesquet, amateur radio call sign Kilo Golf 5, Foxtrot Yankee Golf, during the radio contact. French is the language expected to be used during the contact. The downlink frequency for this contact is 437.525 MHz and may be heard by listeners that are within the space station footprint that also encompasses the ARRIS radio telebridge station. The ARRIS team in Casale Monferrato in Italy will use callsign India Kilo 1 Sierra Lima Delta to serve as the relay ground station. Each student asking a question will be conferenced in from home or socially distanced at school. The contact is scheduled for June the 26th, 2021 at 0925 UTC. Three schools in France will participate in this ARRIS contact. They're all rural schools about 90 miles west of Paris and will involve about 360 students aged 6 to 15 years old. The schools have partnered with the amateur radio club Foxtrot 4 Kilo Lima Quebec in preparation for this contact. Student members of the club have received training from the adult members who have knowledge in the fields of radio, aeronautical and the space scientists in a series of ham radio workshops. And you can watch the live stream of the contact at www.ariotti.com. Ariotti is spelt Alpha Romeo India Oscar Tango Tango India. www.ariotti.com. As time allows, students will ask up to 17 questions, including such matters as what experiments are you working on currently? What is refueling about? What is it like to live away from your family? Is ecology something that you take into account when you go into space? And how many times does it take to get used to zero gravity weightlessness? Other questions are about whether the astronauts have come across asteroids and what they do to avoid them, and what do they miss most when they're on the International Space Station. The students will ask Thomas Pesquet whether he would permit them to name their school after him. You can find out a lot more by getting in touch with the ARRIS media contact, Dave Jordan, Alpha Alpha 4, Kilo November.
And now, with his segment on how to successfully compose a public service announcement to promote your radio club meeting or hamfest on local broadcast radio, here is Arizona's own Greg Stoddard, KF9MP.
In the last three segments on the subject of promoting your ham radio club's event, we covered making a successful public service announcement. In this segment, we'll look into where to send your PSA once it's ready to mail. I'm always collecting addresses for local media outlets. No matter how long I've looked, I'm always finding new places to get free advertising for our local ham radio clubs. In the library, or at most radio stations' business offices, you can find a thick paperback book called the M Street Directory. This is a good reference for names, fax numbers, and addresses of radio stations in North America. Most states have a broadcaster association, and books of addresses and other contact information. Engineering firms who provide technical services to the broadcast industry also keep these books and would no doubt let you copy the pages to begin your collection of local media outlets. For your club's fundraising promotion, I would suggest posting notes in grocery stores, laundromats, schools, libraries, the nearest National Weather Service office, and neighborhood bulletin boards. Mail copies of your PSA to all local radio stations, TV stations, cable TV offices, newspapers, technical vocational schools, on-campus radio and TV stations, and even the local Radio Shack store. As an extra incentive, when you mail your PSA to your local radio and TV stations, include several complimentary admission tickets for the station to use as they see fit with no strings attached. This both allows them to give them away to listeners or offer them to station staff who may also someday become hams and join your ham radio club. If your local radio station is truly active in the community, you can invite them to broadcast live from your event if they want to. They can do this with minimal cost and equipment, sometimes requiring nothing more than a cell phone and a station logo on a banner. So always be looking for new ways to promote your club's fundraiser. In my opinion, in today's computer automated world, the more you automate, the more you mail, the more you collect addresses, the easier and faster you can promote next year's event Over a period of years, with good record keeping, you can turn promotion to a matter of updating last year's PSA, which is still stored in your computer, with the correct date, printing new flyers and PSAs, new address labels, and within 30 minutes, the entire effort can often be a few keystrokes and mouse clicks away from completion. This is Greg Stoddard reporting for This Week in Amateur Radio.
Visually impaired radio amateur Terry Robinson, Golf Mic 3 Whiskey Uniform X-Ray, recently recorded a podcast with the Fourth Valley Sensory Center, in which he talks about his love of amateur radio. Terry is a Fourth Valley Sensory Center trustee, a fundraiser, an amateur radio enthusiast, and an all-round top bloke. In his podcast, he describes his 50-plus years' interest in amateur radio and how it's a great way to meet people all around the world. GM3WUX, who is blind, has built lots of equipment and taken part in many events over the years. In the podcast, you can find out more about how to get involved with amateur radio, a hobby that has increased in popularity during the pandemic, and how you could win a prize for guessing the number of contacts Terry can make during the Islands on the Air competition between the 24th and 25th of July 2021. You can listen to his podcast at soundcloud.com. Just type in Terry Robinson, Amateur Radio.
And finally this week, it seems that the U.S. Postal Service has taken an intense interest too, so much that it's issuing a set of stamps bearing images from NASA's Solar Dynamics Observatory. The stamps feature 10 images received at the observatory, including plasma blasts, solar flares, coronal holes, coronal loops, and those all-important sunspots. NASA launched its Solar Dynamics Observatory in 2010 to collect solar data, including details about the sun's magnetic field and activity on the sun's surface. On Friday, June 18th, the post office issued the stamps during a ceremony in Greenbelt, Maryland. Thomas Marshall, the Postal Service's general counsel and executive vice president, issued a statement saying, "We hope these amazing stamps will help generate the same sense of wonder and curiosity about our star that inspired our ancestors and the scientists at NASA to want to better understand the sun, space, and the myriad of possibilities that exist in our solar system, in our universe, and beyond." Dean Pesnell, project scientist for the observatory, said the observatory has given us the ecology of the sun. It's given us the big picture, one detail at a time. That means that we hams, of course, can now celebrate Solar Cycle 25 one stamp at a time with each QSL card we send.
Many of the news and information items heard on This Week in Amateur Radio have been provided by the American Radio Relay League, the ARRL Letter, the ARRL Audio News, the Southgate Amateur Radio News Service, Southgate Vibes, AMSAT, the Radio Amateurs of Canada, the FCC, the Radio Society of Great Britain and Ofcom, the SARL, the International Amateur Radio Union, the Wireless Institute of Australia, the Amateur Radio Newsline, the International Telecommunications Union, and various news sources on the Internet. This Week in Amateur Radio is heard around the world on the Internet, on low-power FM stations, and on great repeater systems like the WB3GXW repeater, on 147.225 MHz in Silver Springs, Maryland, serving all of Silver Springs and also covering the nation's capital, Washington, D.C. WB3GXW can also be found on Echolink Conference Server Node 6154. If you are a This Week in Amateur Radio affiliate and you would like us to give a free on-air announcement of your station's carriage of the program, please send us an email with the station location, call sign, coverage area, and day and time you air This Week in Amateur Radio, plus any other information you would like us to impart. You can send to the following email, w2xbs77@gmail.com. That address once again is w2xbs77@gmail.com.
This Week in Amateur Radio is produced by Community Video Associates Incorporated. Now, for the staff of This Week in Amateur Radio, this is Jeff Rahner, WB2AEQ, saying 73 until next week. This Week in Amateur Radio is copyright Community Video Associates Incorporated, all rights reserved.